Okay.
All right. Good morning, everybody. This is the Mack Road Church of Christ Sunday, November the 7th worship service recording. For those of you that are watching online, we're glad that we're able to provide this for you. Remember that you will need, let me do this here, you will need your Bible, your communion cup, or some grape juice and some unleavened bread as you listen to this at home and worship God at home. We hope you can come and worship with us soon at the church building. We're hoping that you'll be able to do that and to pray that God blesses you. Remember that those of you that are in the church building, this side should be masked. That side should be unmasked if you like. We want everybody to feel comfortable. And again, we have people that are outside in cars, I think, that are listening to it, who feel more comfortable out there. So we give you that opportunity. All right. So let me see if this will work. All right. Morning, everybody.
Morning.
We're glad you're here and pray the Lord blesses you for having been here, and pray that you are being taken care of by our great and awesome God. Brother Tiny and Donna will be conducting our kids camp today. He showed me some of the stuff they have to do. I kind of want to go back there during the sermon.
Brother Tiny.
I'm sorry, did I say Brother Tiny? No, I meant Brother Sandy and Donna. We'll be back there. He showed me some of the stuff they're going to be doing. I wish I was kind of back there instead of listening to me. And so remember that Sandy also has We Worship during the week. And so make sure you get on his mailing list for that. But remember that it's our responsibility to teach our children. It's not his, it's ours. He does that because he has a love for God. He has a love for your kids. And he wants to help them a little bit in the things that they might learn. But remember, they're going to learn more from you at home than he'll ever be able to teach them here. So if you're not practicing Jesus at home, it's not going to do them a whole lot of good for Sandy to teach them. But we appreciate Sandy's effort and the work that he does. And so we appreciate him and Dawn and the things that they do. All right, Brother Bill's going to be doing our song service for this month. And his first song is Amazing Grace, number 205.
If I remember correctly, the last time I led Amazing Grace, I told you something about John Newton, who wrote the song, and his history as being the captain of a slave trader ship. He used to listen to the slaves singing in the hold of the ship. And through that, working on his conscience, he became converted to Christ, and he wrote this song. And he found that amazing grace. I'm going to walk a different direction today, because Mike's lesson is in John 9 about a man who was born blind, and Jesus healed him. And he gained his sight. So if you will, imagine yourself being blind, being born blind. You've never seen the sunrise. You've never seen the intricate colors and fabrics of a flower or a butterfly or a sunset over the ocean. All of a sudden, you now see. Think about the grace that you feel at that point. And the first verse actually alludes to that. Okay. So if you're blind, you know the song. and at the end, before we start the second verse, you'll know the threats.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I was blind, but now
Amen.
Now, I wanted to sing this one, not knowing that Leroy is going to be leading us in prayer. So when he asked, have you thanked the Lord this morning? You can say, yes! Because you know who's going to ask. Actually, this was a special request from Brother Sandy. Brother Sandy and Brother Leroy have birthdays on Wednesday, the 11th, on Veterans Day. They're both veterans. Also, Lee and Karen have their 49th anniversary on Wednesday, the 11th. So, I think all four of them can say thank you, Lord. Thank you, and we'll help them out. For all that you've done, I will thank you. For all that you're going to do. For all that you promised and all that you are is all that has carried me through. Jesus, I thank you. And I thank you.
I know what you're thinking. I look at all your faces out there and I can just see exactly what you're thinking. But you know, I'm not feeling good this morning. But that's all right, because I know God loves me. Did you thank him this morning?
Yeah.
I just did that. I didn't want to let Bill down. You know? I know all men's are liars, but I didn't want to call him one. You know? It's so good, I'm telling you.
each one of you could get up here and see the thing that I see in this congregation. You know, you would want to stand up here every day, every minute of the day, you know? I see a lot of love. I see a lot of growth, too. Isn't God wonderful? Now I want to get back to this old man stuff. And I said age, not old man, brother. Now you say, you were singing that song about 10,000 years. Can you imagine what you would look like? So now what would you call him? Would you call him old or aged? Well, I think, you know, but you know, 10,000 years with God is just like one day. And God don't have no clock in his hand or nothing. God loves you every day just where you are.
Amen.
And I know he loved me because I go through some pains and things that he's put on me. But you know, that's okay. That's all right. As long as he keep me upright, I'll be all right.
Amen.
But it's good to see you. It's good to be here. It's good to see that you came here for a purpose. God sent you here for a purpose this morning. To really praise him and honor him this morning.
Amen.
And for that, he's going to return all the love that he got for you. And you're going to prosper in life, all of you. Amen. But just keep loving God and keep doing the things you do. And you're going to always be blessed. And I'm going to tell you this. I didn't want to tell you, but I'm going to tell you this. This coming 11th, I'll be 89 years old. Now, let me tell you something. It went fast. Time just flew by. So don't just wait and just hang on and say you love God and don't take any action in this area.
Right.
You know, because I mean, time don't wait on nobody. And you look around there one day and you be standing up here like me saying, I'm 89 years old. So make good use of your time and do things that, you know, that's going to make you prosper in the spirit.
Right.
Not in this world, because this world is not what it is. Just keep loving God and keep loving each other. And just keep me smiling every day. Oh, well, thank you, Dad. And I'm going to God in prayer, okay? Heavenly Father, I thank you. And this congregation, thank you too, Lord. I can see it on their face and see the love that they have for you, Lord, because they know that you love them. And I pray that you continue loving them, Lord, and helping them to really understand the purpose that they have on this earth. And they share it with one another, Lord, and with other people in this world that really don't understand that street that we're walking on. Help us to see that the love that we give others will bring them to you. And it will make us have a lot more love from you for what we give them. So I ask blessing for this congregation. I ask blessing that you would always keep them happy and encourage them to be in the faith, Lord, and help them to make right choices. Because we get off the wrong path one day and you put us back on and we don't see this. You bless us day by day, every day. And that's a lot of us don't realize that we are getting blessings. We just take it for granted that there's someone up there that cares about us, but it's more than that. And we will finally know that what we've been seeking at the day that we see you, Lord, and hold on to your unchanging hand. So I say that you bless this congregation and let us go through this service today that my brother Mike is bringing us from your most gracious and holy book. And I pray some of the words that's in that book that come out to us, to our ears, if we be attentive to these words, may they prick our hearts and make us prosper to the faith. Thank you, Lord, for listening to me. Thank you for just listening to this petition. In the name of Jesus, I pray to you. Amen.
Amen. love of God life. Page 189.
When I survey the wondrous cross on which the Prince of Glory died, my gracious gain I count but loss, and were content on all my pride. Forbid it, Lord, that I should boast, save in the death of Christ my Lord. All the vain things that charm me most,
come to you, we've come to you now to put in our minds what God has done for us from the time when he gave his son for our lives to be here and to be with him. Acts 20 and 7 tells us the first day of the week, just the example that we follow. And then 1 Corinthians 11, and verse 8, 23 through 30 is also the example that we follow. And I shall read. For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, "This is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes." Therefore, whoever eats this bread and drinks this cup of the Lord in unworthy manner will be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For he who eats and drinks in unworthy manner eats and drinks judgment to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this reason, many are weak and sick among you, and may sleep. At this time, I'm going to give a little slight instruction on your cups. There's a little film on the top where your body is, the cracked piece of bread. Just peel that back. Be careful not to break the second seal. I'm going to ask my brother now to do this in a word of prayer.
Dear Father in heaven, we thank you so much for giving us the opportunity to be here today and partake of the Lord's Supper. We ask the Lord to be with us and help us to remember the great sacrifice that Jesus Christ did for us. As we partake of the bread, help us to remember the broken body that he suffered for us. We ask the Lord to forgive us for our sins. In his name, amen.
Be careful now as you put the seal on the cup. Once again, I ask my brother to give us or lead us in prayer for the thanksgiving of the cup of his blood.
Dear Lord, we continue giving you thanks for everything you have done for us. At this time, we thank you for the fruit of the vine that represents the blood that Jesus Christ shed on the cross for us. We ask the Lord to help us to remember Jesus, not only on the first day of the week, but every second, every minute, every hour, every day. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
At this time also, we must remember to give thanks to our Lord for giving us ways and means to earning our keep. Therefore, we give back a portion of what you can comfortably get. It was said in the past, I guess in the Old Testament, that we gave a tenth. But God loves a cheerful giver. If you can, you will at the time, but I tell you what to do. Put it in an envelope for right now. And just leave it in the foyer. We're not passing the basket, just due to this COVID kind of thing. And I'm going to shut my mouth right now because I'm starting to go out there someplace, which I normally kind of do. And I'm going to ask my brother to step forth and pray for all of us at this time to give him thanks.
Dear Lord, at this time, we thank you so much for all the things you provide for us. Yes. Since we wake up in the morning through the end of the day, we should thank you every minute. All the stuff that we have at home, here our houses, our cars, whatever do we have for transportation. We thank you, Lord, and we thank you for answering our prayers. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
626 is also a special request from our brother Sandy. And he asked me to read this song on his birthday every year. Except the majority of us won't be here on Wednesday, and we don't normally sing during Bible class. So, happy birthday, Sandy. And I'm going to ask that if you're willing and you're able, please stand with me. And we're going to let people out in the street know that it is well.
When peace like a river abandons my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well.
Lord. It's time to take your children to we worship if you'd like to at this time.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Please, we want to read the scripture for today's lesson. And we take it from John chapter 9, the book of John chapter 9, from verse 1 to 5. And it says, as he passed by, he saw a man blind from birth. And his disciples asked him, Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he would be born blind? Jesus answered, it is neither that this man sinned nor his parents, but it is so that the work of God might be displayed in him. We must work the works of him who sent me as long as it is day. Night coming when no one can work. While I am in the world, I am the light of the world. Amen.
Amen. Everybody here today? All right, good. We did a little tweaking with our system, and hopefully everybody can hear. If you're visiting with us for the first time, we're glad you're here. Pray the Lord blesses you for being here. And if you notice, the little sermon outline that you received has some blank spaces on it. Those blank spaces will be underlined on the overhead, so you can write those in there if you'd like to have a copy of the sermon. And if not, you just wait afterwards, and I'll be happy to go over them with you. If you want to fill them out, you didn't get them while we were talking. We've been talking about John in for all of this year. As you can tell, we're going to be continuing to talk about it next year. But we're looking at the fact that there is a God, and God created the world through the Word. And the Word became flesh to bring us under God's kingdom. But there are bad things in the world that he made. Why should we enter his kingdom? I'm going to be talking about for a minute about the realities of life. We sometimes don't like talking about them, but we need to understand that they exist, and we need to understand how they work in relationship with God. And as we do that, he says in John chapter 9 and verse 1 and 2, as he passed by, he saw a man blind from birth. And his disciples asked him, Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? And as we think about this man who was born blind, as it says, he passed by and saw a man born blind, it brings up questions that we always ask or we always think about that sometimes bother us and that we need to really figure out. And that is, it has to do with suffering in the world. Because when you see somebody who's born blind, or you see somebody who's born with a defect, or you see somebody who's born with problems, it causes us to think about what's going on in the world, and it causes us to wonder about God. And so as we think about that, let me remind you that you and I live in a cursed world. In Genesis chapter 3 and verse 14, after Adam and Eve sinned, we notice that things changed in the world. In Genesis 3 and verse 14, it says, the Lord God said to the serpent, because you have done this, cursed are you more than all cattle and more than any beast of the field. On your belly you will go, and dust you will eat all the days of your life. And so we notice that as a result of the devil's activity and temptation and man's fall, that things became cursed. In verse 17, it says, and then to Adam, God said, because you have listened to the voice of your wife and have eaten from the tree about which I commanded you, saying you shall not eat from it, cursed is the ground because of you. In toil you will eat of it all the days of your life. And so the fact is that we live in a world that's cursed. And as we think about that idea of living in the world, we need to think about the world in general. We need to think about suffering in general, because suffering happens, not just necessarily when somebody is born blind or when somebody is born lame or crippled or has a birth defect, but we notice that there's just tragedies in the world. My wife and I attended a funeral for a brother of ours, or a friend of ours, a Christian brother of ours, who died at a young age. He had, I believe they call it Lou Gehrig's disease. And so he slowly started to go down, and he got worse and worse as time went. And you kind of ask yourself and you wonder, you know, why would God allow these kinds of things, and what's going on? And so we need to understand something about this world. And that is that the Bible teaches us that this world was set in futility. In Romans 8 and verse 20, it says, for the creation, that's us and the world, for the creation was subjected to futility. Now, I want you to understand that it says it was subjected to futility. God didn't intend for it to be in futility, but it became subject to futility because of sin, because of the curse.
And so God then decided that he needed a world that, as the scriptures teach us here, was futile. But we're going to notice something about this in just a minute. He says, for the creation was subjected to futility, but not willingly. We didn't want to be subject to futility. We don't like the idea of dying. We don't like the idea of our friends having diseases from which they die. We don't like the idea of our grandparents dying or anybody getting cancer. We don't like that. So it wasn't by our will that this happened. And so therefore it says, not willingly, but because of him who subjected it. God says, I'm in control of the world. I know what I'm doing. And because of man's sin, the world needs to be under futility. But he says, but because of him who subjected it in hope. God says this world is subject to futility because God says, I want people hoping for something better. That's why he put it in futility. God wants us to understand that there's something better than just this world, because the thing that got Adam in even trouble was the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life. That's what got Adam in even trouble. She saw the fruit, that it was good for food, and she said it's going to make one wise, and she thought it looked good. And so she based everything she did by this world. And so God says, I'm going to have to do something to show them that this world isn't that good. This world is not what God wants us to focus on, but God wants us to focus on something better than this world. And so he says, I subjected this world to futility. Your cars get old. Your houses need new roofs. Your bodies get sore. And God said, I'm doing that because I want to give you something to hope in, and this world is not what we're supposed to hope in. It's funny, when kids are little, they go, I hope to get older and drive. Those of us who drive all the time said, I wish I didn't have to drive. I wish I had a chauffeur. And so it's funny, the things that we hope for. And so God said, I want them to hope for something better than what's going on in this world. And some in this world have it harder than other people. We see that from time to time. In Luke chapter 13, there's a story about Jesus healing a woman. And it says, as he's talking to the Jews, who are there, who don't really care about helping this woman. It says in verse 15, but the Lord answered him and said, you hypocrites, does not each one of you on the Sabbath untie his ox or his donkey from the stall and lead him away to water? In other words, God says, you religious people that he's talking to, you guys do all this stuff to take care of your animals, but this lady who's hurting, you're not taking care of her, which tells us that one of the things that religion is supposed to do, or put it this way, one of the things that God's people are supposed to do is help one another in need and in those problems. So verse 16, he says, and this woman, I want you to notice this, a daughter of Abraham as she is, whom Satan has bound for 18 long years, should she not be released from the bond on the Sabbath day? Anybody remember what her problem was? She was bent over. For 18 years, she'd been bent over. And everything she did, she had to do like this, bent over. And those of you that are mechanics who bend over cars know what happens after a while you bend over. You know how your back feels. You know the pain. You know what it causes you. And this lady was bent over for 18 years. It just wasn't fair that she suffered so much, especially when there's other people in the world that don't seem to suffer very much. This young person came to Jesus and said, good master, what must I do to inherit eternal life? And Jesus says to the young man, after he told him that you need to go and sell everything you have and give it to the poor, it says this about the man. It says in verse 22, but when the young man heard this statement, he went away grieved, for he was one who owned much property. You see, here you have a woman on one side that's been over for 18 years, and here you have a young man that's just loaded. And life just sometimes doesn't seem fair. And our world wants you to feel bad about the people who have better than you do. And they want you to feel bad about them. That's not what this lesson is about. God's the one who makes us rich, and God's the one who makes us poor. God says we're supposed to love everybody. It doesn't matter your station in life. What I'm just simply trying to tell you is that in this world, there are some people who seem to suffer more than other people, and it's the same world, and sometimes we think it's not fair. And some circumstances are harder to harmonize with God. Like, for example, birth defects. What in the world did that child do to be born that way? My daughter has a special heart. She has a heart for children that are special needs children. And so she spent most of her adult life getting educated in how to take care of those special needs kids. And she's an inclusion specialist in an elementary school taking care of special needs kids. And she has a heart for that. But whenever I go to her class and whenever I get a chance to intermingle with some of the kids, you look at them and you wonder, why were they born this way? Why? It's hard to harmonize with a loving, gracious God. In Acts chapter 3, in verse 2, you have a man, it says in verse 2, a man who had been lame from his mother's womb was being carried along, whom they used to set down every day at the gate of the temple, which is called Beautiful, in order to beg alms of those who were entering the temple. And there's something contradictory about that statement. Do you see it? You know what it is? Here's the temple of God and the gate called Beautiful, and there's a lame guy sitting there. It just doesn't look right. And in chapter 14 and verse 8, it says, at Lystra there was a man sitting who had no strength in his feet, lame from his mother's womb, who had never walked. And you look at them and you go, why? Why in the world does this happen? And some of us, we just ignore it. We just act like it doesn't happen, and we try to ignore it. And we try to act like those people just, they're not our problem. And yet they're in the world. And so what did the atheist do? He says, well, that's because you guys are silly. There's no God. So it's just the evolutionary processes making a mistake. And so therefore, that's what it is. There's no rhyme or reason to it. But I want you to understand that there's value in suffering. We have individuals sometimes in our world that we call helicopter parents or snowplow parents. And those are parents that watch over their kids. They're like helicopters over their kids. And when their kids do anything that might cause them difficulty, they make sure that they remove the circumstances so their child doesn't have difficulty. So therefore, we don't keep score in school. We don't keep score in sports because it might make one of the kids feel bad. And we do those kind of things for the purpose of trying to protect the children so that they don't feel bad. But what I want you to understand is suffering is part of our world. And people who are better than me at certain things is part of the world. And people who are worse than me is part of the world. And what matters is, how do I deal with those people? Not, let's not let them be winners and make me be less than I'm supposed to be just to make somebody else feel better. You see, there's value in suffering. Even Jesus suffered. In Hebrews chapter 5 and verse 8, it says, Jesus learned obedience by the things which he suffered, and he was the Son of God. God allowed his Son to suffer so that he would learn obedience. And I know as we think about Jesus, we think, well, wait, Jesus knows everything. How do you learn obedience? Well, there's a difference between what you might say intellectual knowledge and experiential knowledge. And Jesus had to know and experience what it was like to live as a man. And so he suffered while he was down here. And Jesus was perfected by his suffering. In Hebrews 2 and verse 10, it says, for it was fitting for him for whom are all things and through whom are all things to bring many sons to glory, to perfect the author of their salvation through suffering. See, suffering yields a product in the kingdom of God and in the world that God has here for us. That's why God allowed this world to be placed in futility. And saints are perfected by this suffering that we go through. In 2 Corinthians 4 and verse 17, he says, for momentary light affliction is producing for us an eternal weight of glory, far beyond all comparison. Brother Leroy walked up and the first thing he said was, I'm not feeling well. And my heart goes out to Brother Leroy because I love him. But I can't do anything. I can't take away his pain. I can pray for him, but I can't do anything for him. But he comes up and says, that's okay. Because what matters is not how I'm feeling, but where I'm going to go when this life is over. And that's what matters. And the suffering that we go through often causes us to feel better about where it is that we're going. You know, I have a class at Regency, which is a kind of a nursing facility where some people who can't take care of themselves, but they're mentally there. And so I have a study, and I met a lady that was there, and she was in a wheelchair. And when I was going there, she was in this wheelchair, and she started attending, and we started talking, and before you know it, she got baptized. And she says to me, "Mike, I want you to know something." She says, "I want you to know that had I never had that car accident, I would have never come to Jesus." She says, "Because I had everything I needed. I was up in the corporate ladder. I ate at the fine places. I drove fancy cars. And Jesus was the furthest thing from my desires." Suffering brings us to God. You see, it points to hope. In Romans chapter 8 and verse 21, where we looked at Romans 8 verse 20, verse 21 says that the creation itself also will be set free from its slavery to corruption into the freedom of the glory of the children of God. Leroy comes up and he says, "I'm hurting." But in his mind, he's thinking, "There's going to be a day when I'm not going to hurt anymore. There's going to be a day when I'm going to be able to walk and I'm going to be able to talk." And Brother Lowe had his problems with stroke, and now he's having a hard time hearing. There's going to come a day when he's going to hear a needle drop. And so because of these things, we look more forward to heaven. He says, "For we know that the whole creation groans and suffers the pains of childbirth together until now. And not only this, but also we ourselves, having the first fruit of the spirits, even we ourselves groan within ourselves, waiting eagerly for our adoption as sons, the redemption of our body." I know Leroy's hurting, but I like Leroy here.
Amen.
And I like Brother Lowe here. They're encouragements while they're here. But we suffer. We suffer in this world. So how do believers try to harmonize and make sense of this? Especially if you happen to be one who has a child that was born with a defect or is crippled or lame or blind, and you're trying to figure out, how does that fit with God? Verse 2 says, and his disciples asked him, "Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he would be born blind?" In other words, they said, whose fault it is? Because there's a human assumption, and that human assumption is God is good. And by the way, he is. But there's more to that assumption. In Matthew 19, an individual came to Jesus and said to him, in verse 16, and someone came to Jesus and said, "Teacher, what good thing shall I do to inherit eternal life?" And Jesus said to him, "Oh, why are you asking me about what is good? There's only one who is good." And so people say God is good. And so therefore, how can all this birth defects and these kinds of accidents and terrible things that happen in our world, how in the world can we harmonize that with God? And their answer is, well, birth defects can't be in God's plans. Because after all, James chapter 1 says in verse 17, every good thing given and every perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shifting shadow. And so we say, see, they can't be from God, because God only gives us what's good. And our problem is we are thinking like us. And we are thinking about our standard of perfection and our standard of goodness is what we're thinking about. And so what's their answer? Well, since God is good and birth defects certainly can't be from God, then it must not be God's fault. They're suffering because of sin. What's interesting is in 2 Samuel 3 and verse 28, there's this 28 and 29, there's this statement that David makes about a couple of individuals. This is what he says about them. He says, afterwards, when David heard it, he said, "I and my kingdom are innocent before the Lord forever of the blood of Abner, the son of Ner. May it fall on the head of Joab and on all his father's household, and may there not fail from the house of Joab one who has a discharge, or who is a leper, or who takes hold of a distaff, or who falls by the sword, or who lacks bread." In other words, David says, the person I'm talking about, did something that was so terrible, he deserves to be punished, and not just him, but his whole family and his whole line. What was it that the man did? Well, verse 30 says, so Joab and Abishai, his brother, killed Abner. By the way, if you're doing your reading, you know who I'm talking about. If you're not doing your reading, you got no idea who I'm talking about. But basically, they killed Abner. And they killed him at a time when there was no war going on. And so therefore, David is saying, you deserve all these things to happen to you. And we go, yeah, right. You see, it doesn't bother us when we see some criminal who gets shot in the course of robbing a store. We kind of go, oh, he deserved it. But a baby? Born innocent? See, the human answer is, whose fault is it? So there's a question. Here's the question is going to come up in John 5, and verse 14. It says, and afterwards, Jesus found him. This was the man who he had healed, who was lame. He says, Jesus found him in the temple and said to him, behold, you have become well. Do not sin anymore so that nothing worse happens to you. You see, we don't mind and it doesn't bother us when people receive the consequences of their crime and they suffer for it. Like, for example, when a junkie gets addicted, we understand why he gets addicted. It bothers us he's addicted, but we understand it. He's doing something wrong. But birth defects? So whose fault is it then? Maybe it's his parents' fault. You know, babies are often born blind because sometimes the parents are not blind, but with diseases or problems, sometimes because the parents do drugs. Or maybe sexually transmitted diseases, or maybe some other disease. My wife and I know a lady who has a son who was born. He can't hear, he can't see, he can't talk, nothing. He's just like a person that's there and knows nothing, does nothing, can't take care of himself. That's the way he is. And they say it was because she had, I believe it was measles at the time or something, that she happened to give birth to him. And so maybe it's the parents' fault. Maybe that's why he was born blind. Maybe that's the problem. Well, sometimes that does happen. Or maybe it's the child's fault because after all, we're all sinners. We're all born in sin according to some people. And so we're born in sin. So maybe God just punishes this child before he's born because he's a sinner anyway. Because you see, we have to harmonize birth defects and those kinds of activities with a loving, kind, gracious God. And so it can't be God. So we need to change and figure out what it is that could be happening. So therefore, it must be the parent sinned or the child sinned. Because it can't be in God's plans. In Ecclesiastes chapter 9 and verse 1, it says, for I have taken all this to my heart and explained it, that righteous men, wise men, and their deeds are in the hand of God. And man does not know whether it will be love or hatred. Anything awaits him. It is the same for all. There is one fate for the righteous and for the wicked, for the good, for the clean, and for the unclean, for the man who offers a sacrifice and for the one who does not offer sacrifice. As the good man is, so is the sinner. As the swearer is, so is he who is not afraid to swear. Ecclesiastes writer says, you don't know God's plan. We can't be the ones who determine God's plans. God says sometimes bad things happen to good people and sometimes good things happen to bad people. He says, you don't know what it's going to be. You don't know when you get older, you're going to be in so much pain you can't get out, or whether you're going to be able to live to 99 and run around driving a car. We actually met a lady like that at a restaurant once. And so God has to bring some light on this dilemma. God has to give us an answer. It says in John chapter 9 and verse 3, and Jesus said, it was neither that this man sinned nor his parents. Well, that doesn't help. Jesus said, parents didn't sin and the child didn't sin. That's not why this happened. Then why born blind? Well, let me remind you of something. Psalms 139 verse 13, David writes, for you formed my inner word parts. You wove me in my mother's womb. Ecclesiastes 11 and verse 5 says, just as you do not know the path of the wind and how bones are formed in the womb of a pregnant woman, so you do not know the activity of God who makes all things. Who makes everything? God does. Who knows that child's going to be born that way? God does. Who knows that that man was going to be born blind? God did. Matter of fact, it seems to say, as a result of what God knows, that's part of what happened. And that's kind of why it happened. You see, Jesus says this person born blind in this particular case is not as a result of personal sin. Remember the story of Job? Remember Job? And you remember that in Job chapter 2 and verse 3 through 6, I'm not going to read that all for you, I'll tell it to you, that Satan said to Job, of course Job loves you, of course Job is faithful to you because you build a hedge around him and he has his health. And we all know that if you have your health, you have everything. Well, Brother Lowe doesn't have all his health now. Well, God's going to find out something about Brother Lowe. And God's going to find out something about Job. Because Job didn't sin. We know Job didn't sin. I don't know about Walter. I'm just kidding. But we know Job didn't sin. And yet, God allowed Satan to make him sick. And not just sick, but I mean, a sickness where he had boils from the top of his head to the bottom of his feet. Kids would make fun of him when he's in the marketplace. And his wife said his breath stunk. And Job says, why don't you just kill me? God says, no. I want you around. You see, God says about this man born blind, but it was so that the works of God might be displayed in him. Amen. God says, I want him that way. I made him that way. So that in him, the works of God might be known. You see, what matters is God's light on this information that we're dealing with. In Colossians 1 and verse 16, it says, for by him all things were created, both in the heavens and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authority, all things have been created through him and for him. God says, I made them and I made them for me, and I'm the one who created them. So God made me get old. Yeah. God allows people to have cancer? Yes. Even though they didn't do anything? Yes. God allows people to be born blind or deaf or mute or all of them? God allows that? Yes. Because it's his world and it's for him. Now don't misunderstand that. That doesn't mean God doesn't have a plan. Because this blind man can do exactly the same thing everybody else can do. And it's the same thing everybody else needs to do. And that is glorify God. Whether Jesus heals him or not has nothing to do with it. What it has to do with is whatever God blessed us with, are we willing to thank God and recognize who he is and acknowledge him? Because when you think about it in the garden, why did God make us the way he did? In Genesis chapter 2 and verse 7, it says, then the Lord God formed man of the dust from the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. Yes, Lord, but when I fall down, I bump my head. It hurts. Why'd you make me like this? And God, I can fall off a roof and kill myself. God, why did you make me like this? Or I can be cutting up meat and cut my finger. Lord, why did you make me like this? Why did you make me indestructible like the superheroes we see on television? Because God says, it's my world. And I want to show people how much I care. And so therefore I have to make you in a way that you need. Even before Adam and Eve sinned, they needed God. They needed him. He made the trees grow. He made the fruit grow. He made the water sustain us. He made us like this. God's the one who made us like this. He's the one. Because God has the right over the clay. In Jeremiah chapter 18, there's a story of Jeremiah going to a potter's house. And Jeremiah watches the potter in the clay, and he takes the clay and he puts it up and he puts it down. Have you ever seen people work with clay? They have that wheel that turns and they spin it. They're working with the clay, and you wonder what in the world they're making. Well, the first thing they have to do is figure out the quality of the clay. And so they work with the clay to figure out if they can make something very, very delicate, or whether they make something very thick that's not going to break, because the clay is not very good. And God says the potter can do whatever he wants to with the clay. And God says, I can do whatever I want to with my clay, because the purpose for the clay is to bring glory to the potter. In Romans chapter 9, and down here in verse 19, it says, you will say then, why does he still find fault? For who resists his will? On the contrary, who are you, O man, who answers back to God? The thing molded will not say to the molder, why did you make me like this, will it? Or does not the potter have right over the clay to make from the same lump one vessel of honorable use and another for common use? God says, can't I make somebody who's really smart and somebody who's a little short of brains? God says, can't I make somebody who's tall and somebody who's short? Can't I make somebody who's broad and somebody who's skinny? God says, can't I do whatever I want to? And can't I make some darker and some lighter? Can't I do that, God says? That's his world. You see, our problem is we sometimes think it's our world. And so in that sense, everybody who's born in this world is perfect. As far as God is concerned. Now, that doesn't mean they're not going to be suffering in the world. They might. But it means God made them the way God wanted them to be. And when he did so so that he would receive glory. In 1 Timothy 6 and verse 13, after all, it says, I charge you in the presence of God, who gives life to all things, and of Christ Jesus, who testifies the good confession before Pontius Pilate. God says, I give life to everybody. I give it. And even those not healed show God's work. You see, when I heard that Brother Walter had a stroke, I was wondering, how's that going to affect him? I mean, sometimes people have a stroke and they can't walk, can't talk, can't see different things. But my real question was, how's it going to affect him? Well, I know how it affected him. He's here.
Okay.
He's here. And the work of God is seen in that.
That's right.
The work of God is being seen in Walter.
That's right.
Right now. Because it's nothing for me to be here. But for Walter and Leroy and people that are hurting in the flesh, when they're here, it gives glory to God. You remember Paul's thorn in the flesh? We're not exactly sure what it was, but in 2 Corinthians 12 and verse 7, it says, Paul says, because of the surpassing greatness of the revelation for this reason, to keep me from exalting myself, there was given me a thorn in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to torment me, to keep me from exalting myself. Concerning this, I implored the Lord three times that it might leave me. And he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for power is perfected in weakness. Paul says, can you get rid of this thing that's bugging me? God says, no. No. I'm not going to. Because I'm going to see if my grace is sufficient for you. I'm going to see if my good favor that I'm bestowing upon you and that you have coming to you is going to be enough to satisfy you no matter what happens to your body in this life. And so in verse 9, he says, most gladly, therefore, I would rather boast about my weaknesses so that the power of Christ may dwell in me. See, we like boasting about our health. We like boasting about how strong we are and how much money we have and how rich we are. And Paul says, no, I'm going to boast about my weaknesses. I'm going to boast about the fact that I have a thorn in the flesh, but God still loves me. People might not love me, but God still loves me. But I do want you to understand something. God says they're messengers of Satan, because remember, the world was subjected to futility. God never meant it. The reason the world was subjected to futility was partly because of Satan and what Satan did and what Satan put in the mind of Adam and Eve. And so therefore, Satan is the one who's really causing all these problems and difficulties, as God is trying to work through that, as we individually have the right to choose to follow God or to follow Jesus or to follow Satan. And so notice in 2 Corinthians 12, verse 7, talking about Paul's thorn, it says, "There was given to me a thorn in the flesh, a messenger of Satan." See, Adam and Eve, when he put them in the garden, they had no thorn in the flesh. It's not God's intention. But because of sin and because of sin in the world, God allowed Satan to do with some of us what God allowed Satan to do to Job. And in Luke 13, you remember that woman that was bent over? It says in Luke 13, verse 16, it says, "Whom Satan had bound for 18 years. So God says, "You need my light in the world." Verse 4 says, "We must work the works of him who sent me as long as it is day. Night is coming when no one can work. While I am in the world, I am the light of the world." You see, we have to work in the light of God. And by the way, that means while he's alive, we have to work. To work in the light means that we're alive. In Ephesians 5 and verse 15, he says, "Therefore, be careful how you walk, not as unwise men, but as wise, making the most of your time, because the days are evil. So then do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is." I almost didn't preach because of what Leroy said earlier. He said, "I'm 89. And he says, "Time has gone by like that. And so you guys better do something." That's my lesson. Because night is coming when no one can work. Ecclesiastes 9 and verse 10, he says, "Whatever your hand finds to do, do it with all your might. For there is no activity of planning or knowledge or wisdom in Sheol where you are going." We're only going to get this life. And we're only going to get to work this life. There's no reincarnation. There's no being reborn into some place before we get to the judgment day. There's this life. And the question is, even though we're not blind, is God going to be glorified by us? You see, Jesus is the light of the world. He says, "While I'm in the world, I am the light of the world." Jesus won't physically stay here. He's going to be leaving us. But while he's here, while he was with them, he was the light of the world. He says, "In him was life, and the life was the light of men." The way we learn the truth is by reading our Bible and understanding who God is. And that's how we learn the truth. And that's what keeps us from understanding error and therefore going off into things that are futile and aren't any good for us. He is how we're to view the world. That's why in Colossians 3 and verse 17, it says, "Whatever you do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus. Giving thanks through him to God the Father." See, that's why everything we do according to what God says, because he's the one that knows the light. He's the one that knows the truth. He's the one that knows reality. We're all sitting around trying to figure out how to do things, walking in the dark. And God says, "I'm a light. I can tell you how to do it. And I can tell you what's important." And we're here to do his will. In John 8 and verse 12, even when Jesus leaves, he says, "Then Jesus again spoke to them, saying, 'I am the light of the world. He who follows me will not walk in darkness, but will have the light of life.'" You know why people believe in evolution? Because they're not following the light of life. You know why people believe that some people are less important than other people? Because they're not following the light. You know why some people think being rich is more important than a poor person? Because they're not following the light. You know why some people think that people born in birth defects are imperfect and broken? Because they're not following the light. God spoke creation into existence by his word. And Jesus, being the eternal I am, is the source of light on earth. And Jesus' light illuminates every situation to his glory. And those who believe Jesus is to be glorified in our lives will be born again of water and the Spirit in his name to receive eternal life. And it doesn't matter the condition of your body. If we can aid or help in any way, we ask you to come. All together we stand and sing.
Jesus, name above all names, beautiful Savior, glorious Lord, Emmanuel, God is with us, blessed Redeemer, living Word.
Thank you, Lord, for this time we've had this morning to come and hear a message from your word. We're thankful for Mike preparing this lesson, and we're here to hear it. We're thankful for you sending your son to earth and living a perfect life and dying for our sins. Lord, we ask that you be with those that are suffering at this time with various ailments, and those who've lost loved ones, that your hand would be upon them and comfort them in their time of need. We're thankful for the visitors you brought our way this morning. We ask that you be with them and bless them and be with us as we depart here today. We're so thankful for the many blessings you give us each and every day, Lord. And we ask that we, as we spend the rest of our days here on earth, that we would use our time wisely and use it to glorify you. To your son's name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Just some real quick announcements, and then we're going to have our service report, and hopefully, I'm talking to the men who are going to give it when I say this, try to be quick.
Yeah.
Those in need of prayer, remember George and Walter, and Walter's here, so he's doing good, but keep in your prayers. Hilda's knee, we're going to have our service report. Remember, we want to have holiday baskets to pick it up. And this is from Brother Spencer, and... he says, need prayer for travel. So he's going to be traveling to Stanford for to the cancer center because he's battling cancer. And so keep in your prayers if you would. Make sure if you want a holiday basket that you use the forms that you need, and we'll give those to Lorraine. The holiday basket will be picked up on the 21st. And remember, Brother Ben is going to be leaving us. If not, this is his last Sunday, then next Sunday will be. So make sure you greet him and talk with him. Tiny, since you're up here, why don't you go for this?
Well, it's just I have a report here. Well, I'll go first. To all our visitors, I just want to welcome you all here.